Hello friends, this is a slideshow on formalism. As we know that in literary theory, formalism refers to critical approaches that analyze, interpret, or evaluate the inherent features of a text. So a text can be a novel, a drama, it can be a poem, and when we try to analyze, interpret or evaluate this text to understand the inherent. Inherent means such features of a text which are not visible on the surface level. What is the theme? What is the meaning? What are the literary terms used? What can be the basic meanings of these literary terms? These features include not only grammar and syntax, because mostly what happens in India particularly, when we try to explain as a teacher any poem or novel or a drama, first of all, in all the states of India, the teachers try to interpret that text in the easier language. But that does not mean that you are interpreting or analyzing. Let me explain it that formalism, the word has come from the word form. What is the form? And this kind of criticism is totally away from the biographical criticism, which was, you know, in trend earlier. If we see right from the beginning, right from the Plato and Aristotle, we see 16th century, 17th century, 18th century, 19th century, we find that critics were more involved in analyzing a text or a drama or a poem based on the biographical details. But now these critics say that the form can give us the exact meaning. Form means what is the form in which the work has been written. So you can understand that features of a text which a formalist critic will pay attention to, the grammar. Like, let me give some example of grammar also. Like, suppose a writer is more of using simple sentences in a sentence with one finite verb. It means the thought process is simple, okay? And suppose that writer is using more complex sentences, more compound sentences. For example, he's using more conjunctions like that, which, who, whom. It means there is more connectivity in the thoughts, so that we can understand by analyzing grammar also that what was the mental condition when the work was written. Syntax means what kind of sentence structure comes. Friends, it is very important for all of us to understand that formalism studies, like suppose a writer is using very say monosyllabic words, simple words. Simple here I mean to say monosyllabic means smaller words. And suppose the writer is using more idioms, more proverbs, it means the complexity of thoughts, more artistry is there, you know, in his language. So that is the way we understand a text in formalistic criticism. Also literary devices such as meter and tropes. Apart from that, suppose there is a poem, then the teacher, instead of, or that formalistic critic, instead of, you know, talking more about the inherent psychological you know, insights into the writer's mind, instead of that, he or she will be making more use of the meter. Like suppose the writer is using iambic pentameter, or say trochaic meter or anapestic meter, these are the names of the meters. Then what can be the meaning of that text, or what kind of metaphorical language? Tropes means metaphorical language. What metaphor has been used and how this metaphor can give us a detailed meaning of a particular text. The formalistic approach reduces the importance of a text to historical, biographical and cultural context. So here we can understand, as I said earlier, that a formalistic critic, it does not go to the history that when text was written. For example, suppose I am doing a formalistic analysis you know, of a text of Shakespeare, then I will not go, like, you know, when I will not go into the details of biographies or biographical details of Shakespeare, historical understanding of that period, or say cultural context, like in which context that play was written, and that can give us a meaning. Okay. Second point is formalism rose to prominence in the earlier 20th century. As I earlier said, that before 20th century, critics were more involved in doing biographical, historical, cultural kind of criticism. But with the advent of the 20th century, with the starting of the 20th century, there was a reaction to such things. Okay. And you all know that when Wordsworth, Coleridge, Keats, Shelley, these writers, you know, whom we call romantic, they were more prone, they were more eager, interested to do a kind of, you know, romanticism while, you know, they are writing text. So before that, romanticism meant to say more on the other features of the text. So these theories were very much famous in literature before 20th century, which centered on the artist and individual creative genius. You all know that there are writers, for example, Wordsworth, Keats, you know, these, they consider that Shelley, he says that in that defense of poetry, that poet is an unacknowledged legislator of the world. It means they give more importance to the writer. But these formalistic critics, they say that no, artist is not center, his creative genius is not center. What is more important, the text he has produced, and itself back into the spotlight to show how the text was indebted to forms. And then they say that these writers and the biographical details, historical detail and cultural context of the situations which were responsible to give birth to that text. Instead of that, they say that text itself, whatever is the condition in which text is available, that is more important, and its form is more important, and other works that had preceded it is not as important. So third point is, two schools of formalist literary criticism developed. One is called Russian formalism. Very simple, because, you know, it started in Russia, so we term it Russian formalism. And then there was another one, that is Anglo-American. Why we call it Anglo-American? Because there were some critics, they were in England, and then there were some critics in America. So both combinedly gave certain theories, which is called New Criticism. I will explain what is the difference between New Criticism and formalism exactly. Russian formalism, let us talk about now, refers to the work of the Society for the Study of Poetic Language. You can see this short form, OPOYAZ. So you should understand that, you know, they can ask you this term also. That was, you know, a Russian term for society, work of the Society for the Study of Poetic Language. They formed a group, okay, which was centered in St. Petersburg, and it was founded in 1916, okay, by Boris Eschenbaum. You should remember this. They have asked this question in net 2-3 times, that it was this OPOYAZ, this society, you know, for study of poetic language. It was founded by Boris Eschenbaum. Second was Viktor Slowacki, and third was Yuri Tinenov. So now we can understand that these three major critics are related to formalism, or say formalistic approach of literary criticism. Apart from that, was another name who was very important secondarily, that is, after the starting of this study of poetic language, that Society for Poetic Language in Moscow, there was another Moscow Linguistic Circle. They can also ask you this question. It was founded by Roman Jakobson. Clear? So then there are four names which are important, and they all advocated the importance of text and its form, and not historical, biographical and cultural conditions in which the text was generated. Next slide. Now we can see this name, Vladimir Prop. He was a folklorist. Folklorist mean to say he tried to understand the folk tales of Russia. Okay, and he's also often associated with the movement this is the fifth name, friends, apart from the names I have just taken. Vladimir Prop. This is more an important writer than, I can't say that someone is more important than the other, but yes. His formal method, he created, you know, kind of theory that folklore, folk cult, stories can be understood by understanding a particular form in which they work. Okay, and then Eschenbaum, some very famous essay, The Theory of the Formal Method. The Theory of the Formal Method. They developed a theory, actually provides an economical overview of the approach. Economical overview of the approach means in a very fruitful manner, beneficial. Economical here means beneficial overview of the approach the formalists advocated, which included the following basic points. So now we are going to study this A, B, C, D, E, 5 points which are important to understand in nutshell what they wanted to study and how they wanted to study. The aim is to produce a science of literature. So friends, they can ask you another question this way, that before that, there was not a science, okay? There was more of a kind of understanding which is individualistic and which varied according to writer to writer, clear? But when these formalistic critics came, they said that there is a science of literature also that would be both independent and factual. So they said that, you know, literature is independent of the other fields and there can be a more factual detail. Let me tell you one thing, that, you know, with the starting of the 20th century, there was more of understanding of anything from scientific point of view. So they started, you know, studying literature also from scientific point of view. And then every sentence, every word, every syllable, every, you know, aspect of literature, they also started, you know, by dividing it into form, its structure. So we can also say that, you know, when we are studying the structure of language, structure of meter, structure of metaphors, then we can say that, you know, you are studying the form. For example, you don't talk about how comfortable you feel in a house or how lovable and affectionate you felt or warmth you felt in a house. Instead of that, you just talk about how many rooms are there in a house, how it looks, what is the paint's color, you know. So like an engineer, you just talk about, you know, factual details of poetry or say novel or say drama. Then we call that was the aim, that you reduce literature to the scientific point, and which is sometimes designated by the term poetics. So you should understand poetics. Some students get confused that poetics means poetry. No. Poetics mean some factual detail of something so that it can easily be understood. And that is why Aristotle's famous work Poetics, you know, today you see poetics like, suppose I say the poetics of drama, poetics of poem, it means systematic study of something. That means poetics. Second is, since literature is made of language, so linguistics will be a foundational element of the science of literature. So you will find that more of these formalistic critics, they understand and try to understand literature by understanding the linguistic aspects, how many synonyms have been used in a particular line. Suppose one word is used in the starting, then the writer has used the opposite of that word at the end. Okay, so more of through vocabulary, through grammar, through meter, through, you know, linguistic aspects, through grammar, they try to understand the foundational elements of literature, and then they called it science of literature, though it is quite oxymoronic and paradoxical, because today we are in the habit of calling literature a different thing and science a different thing. Clear? Literature is, we consider that literature is more of emotions, aesthetics, something which cannot be measured. Clear? But they said no, literature can also be measured. See, literature is autonomous from external conditions in the sense. Now they gave a point which is very important to understand. They said that literature is autonomous. It fulfills its own conditions. It does not depend on anything else. And if you remember this word independent few moments back in A point, that it is not dependent on historical, biographical, cultural context. It is autonomous from the external condition. External conditions mean political conditions, economic conditions, in the sense that literary language is distinct from ordinary uses of language. And the third important point is also that, you know, in a common language, suppose I say, bring me a glass of water. Now it means, I simply mean that I'm thirsty and I want to drink a glass of water. But if suppose the same line comes in a poem, then you know we can understand that you know this language, bring me a glass of water in a poem, is totally distinct from the ordinary language. Here they depart from you know common understanding. Otherwise, literature can become also you know a kind of common thing. But they say that no, this language which is used in literature is totally different, not least because it is not entirely communicative. Now they also denied this fact. Look here, there are two nots, not least because it is not entirely communicative. They did not feel that if I say bring me a glass of water in a poem, then you all know that if in a class, suppose I'm a teacher and I'm teaching a poem, and in that a line comes, bring me a glass of water. But it does not mean that all the students go outside the class to bring for me a glass of water. It means it is not communicative. That way it is totally different kind of language. So C point, I think you have understood that it means formalistic critics consider that language which is used in literature is not ordinary language. It has a very different purpose. And then they analyze that purpose linguistically. Fourth, literature has its own history. Literature has its own history means literature's history is different than the writer's history or the nation or that society where from where the writer has come, that history, clear? So literature has its own history of innovation in formal structures. For example, sonnet. Suppose I'm a writer in 20th century, write a sonnet. Then my sonnet should be understood, should be compared, can be compared with the sonnets which were written in the 16th century. Clear? So it means history of innovation in formal structure, that how my sonnet has been different and how it is more innovative in formal structure and is not determined as some crude version of Marxist habit by external material history. It means what we say crude versions of Marxism here, it means very strict Marxist analysis. So they don't analyze, because you know if we talk about culture and history, then cultural history, as Marx said, that culture is determined by base and superstructure. There is poor and rich, you know, these classes, and accordingly you know the things are produced in literature. So they don't you know fall in these kind of categories. They simply say that literature has its own history. It is different than the history of mankind, society, a particular caste, a particular community. Okay, it is not related to the material history. Material history means the history of society, countries, you know, and economy. So that is called material history. So this point is also clear, that literature can, suppose we compare literature, then it should be compared from a very different angle. Fifth point, what a work of literature says cannot be separated from how the literary work says it. Now there are two questions. What a poem says, what a novel says, what a drama says cannot be separated from how the literary work says it. If this what and how, if it says something and the way it says something is one and the same thing, they are not separated, they are not different. And therefore the form of a work, far from being merely the decorative wrapping of an isolable content. Form means, suppose you have put your ideas in a sonnet, in a couplet, in a quatrain, in a phrase, and you have tried to make your language decorative, you know, and you have covered it in a beautiful vocabulary. That means it is in fact part of the content of the work. That aesthetics, that metaphor, that decorative sentence is also part of work. It means what is said and how it is said is one and the same thing. That is again another important question for us from that point of view. I'm going to the next slide now. Then we see that these people contributed two of the most well-known concepts, you know, in the study of formalism. Defamiliarization, one term. Okay, which is, if translated literally, it means estrangement. And the plot story distinction, that is sujet and fabula. Those students who want to understand it, I have uploaded one video on my YouTube channel also. They can go there and watch it. the difference between that. But now let me explain it first of all. Slowakis and these all writers, you know, somehow they are given the credit of giving particular two terms, and that is defamiliarization. Now, what is defamiliarization? It is one of the crucial ways in which literary language distinguishes itself from ordinary communicative language. Means when a poet uses, or a novelist or a dramatist uses, a particular language in a particular poem or in a particular drama, then he or she makes that language a bit estranged, though he uses the same sentences. But anyhow, the way of writing is, his artistic way of writing makes that language quite different. Okay, and is a feature of how art in general works. You all know that the same kind of language we use in our ordinary life. For example, suppose I say, "Hey, you dog, I'll kill you." Suppose I speak this dialogue in a drama, then you can understand this is the same language. If suppose I you know, abuse someone like this, but then another meaning will be you know, added when we look at the, or listen to it in the drama, the same sentence, namely by presenting the world in a strange and new way that allows us to see things differently. It means the same language is used, but with a slight artistic way, the writer makes it quite estranged for us, quite familiar, but you know, that familiarity is distorted, that familiarity is killed, and then the same sentence is used in such a way that, you know, it looks new to us. I hope you understand it. Means in a work of art, a writer does not, though it seems that he is using the same language, but anyhow, he or she adds something to the language, to the art, that, you know, it becomes new for us, and we start looking at the same thing in a very different manner. Okay, so innovation in literary history is, according to Slowacki, partly a matter of finding new techniques of defamiliarization. So you see that, you know, film after film we watch, and again there is same kind of songs are there, kind of same songs, means almost same theme is there, but the writers or the artists who are producing them, creating them, generating them, they create a very different, you know, they add something new, and that new makes us, or makes that particular thing, different and less familiar, you know, with which we are associated. Clear? So this concept of defamiliarization is very crucial in the formalistic criticism. Okay, what is formalism? Again, I ask you, formalism means, this defamiliarization means a way of saying in a very different manner, which makes it different from the ordinary language. Okay, and next is, what is plot and story? You should know this, that plot and story distinction separates out the sequence of events the work relates. Sequence of events is called the story. Like a child is born, then, you know, he grows up, then he goes to school, then, you know, he passes the college, then, you know, he gets a job. Suppose you are showing this. So these are events. The sequence of events is called story. From the sequence in which those events are presented in the work, it is called plot. So I hope you have understood that event one after the other, if we know, suppose you are telling somebody the story of a movie, then you will simply be giving them in a sequence to that person. Okay, and then what is plot? Plot means that sequence in which those events are presented. Now, if you are telling someone that in that movie or in that novel, suppose let us take example of Othello, that Othello marries Desdemona, then he goes to Cyprus, there his mind is poisoned by Iago. Okay, so that way, this is, you know, the events according to the time sequence. But how they are presented in a work, okay, how these are presented in a work, that is called plot. So this is quite different, because, you know, story can be told in the real time also, in our lifetime. And plot means it can be different directors, different writers will present the same story in a very different manner. For example, suppose some director wants to replay or redirect the play Othello. But now, suppose he shows the scene of killing of Desdemona first, and then he, you know, in what we call it, in flashback technique, he shows all the events earlier happened. He shows them later on. It means how the events are arranged in a work of art. That is called plot. So you can understand that, you know, this is the difference. This is the way they analyze a work of art, by understanding its events and then how they were produced, how they were sequenced in a literary work. Next point is, both of these concepts, means story and plot, are attempts to describe the significance of the form of a literary work. That how they, these two works, these two points, story and plot, how they give significance to the literary work in order to define its literariness. This is literariness. That suppose you tell the story, or suppose an uninformed, less imaginative teacher comes in the class and simply tell the story. But that is story. But suppose a director listens to it, or some student who becomes director later on, his artistry, his literariness lies in what? The way he or she represents the same story by presenting events, or they disturb the sequence and accordingly they present it, you know, on the celluloid, or say on TV, or say on stage. For the Russian formalists as a whole, form is what makes something art to begin with. They consider that, you know, form is more important. How you, let me explain it. I want to take one example here. Suppose you have floor, F-L-O-U-R, you know, with which we prepare bread or roti. Now, five people are there, and five people have the same material, okay? So story is material. And five people present or say artistically prepare five different kinds of rotis or breads. Somebody will be adding some, you know, butter inside also, making it more soft. Somebody will stuff potatoes in between. Okay, make it a kind of sandwich. We call it paratha. Somebody will, you know, prepare a puri. Somebody will, you know, have layers and layers and layers of the same flour, or the dough, we call it, you know, after kneading it. We call it in Hindi gunda hua atta. And then we find that there is a lachhedar paratha. It means the same material, but artistically presented in different form. So suppose, you know, a judge is there, and he wants to analyze, like, you know, who is the winner of this art. Then he will be studying the form, that in what form there was more labor, what form, you know, created the same material in a more soft manner. So this is the thing Russian formalists did, that they said that form is what makes something art to begin with. Art lies in form. So in order to understand a work of art as a work of art rather than as an ornamented communicative act, one must focus on its form. One should understand, like, you know, what formalistic approaches have been used, or techniques have been used. This emphasis on form, this stress on form, seemingly at the expense of thematic content. Now you have understood that suppose I am a you know, a judge of a cookery show, and I just see, like, you know, what form is there in parathas, puris and lachhedar parathas and other things, and I don't pay attention to what is the content, what kind of flour has been taken, whether it is healthy or not, is there more pesticide, or say that kind of wheat was used to make a flour, or you know, which was less organic. So, you know, thematic content at the expense means they did not pay attention to the thematic content, was not well received. And this is the reason that, you know, it was not well received. This formalism, you know, it was a very transitory kind of, you know, ism in literary theory after the Russian Revolution of 1917. What happened? One of the most sophisticated critique of formalistic project was Leon Trotsky's Literature and Revolution. Now I'll be just talking about it, like why Russian formalism, you know, fell out of favor after the Russian Revolution. Next slide. So, Jan Mokorowski, a member of the Prague Circle, described it in 1920s, consists in the maximum of foregrounding of the utterance. Whatever is said in a poem, in line, in a drama, in a novel, whatever is said, and suppose we want to foreground it, it means we want to bring it into the highest prominence. Being a formalistic critic, suppose I want to analyze the form of a particular work, then I will foreground some sentence, some part of that particular work, clear? And that expression, that act of speech, I will just study as a formalistic critic. So here I have explained that to what is the meaning of foregrounding. Foregrounding means to bring something into the highest prominence, highest understanding, highest limelight, to make it dominant in perception, so that we, being a writer, we being a reader, perceive it, understand it more. And the opposite of foreground is background. What is the meaning of backgrounding? The referential aspect and the logical connections in language. Poetry makes the words themselves palpable as phonic sign. This line is very important to understand. Backgrounding means the referential aspects, other references in the text and the logical connections in the language. That means backgrounding it. Poetry makes the words themselves palpable as phonic. So that is background, that you don't, the structure meaning, if you are bringing in prominence and you are understanding the structural meaning, and then suppose you are understanding its sound and other effects, then we call it backgrounding. What is in the background? The primary aim of literature in thus foregrounding its linguistic medium, as Slowoski put it in an influential formulation, is to estrange or defamiliarize. And when a work of art is studied in such a manner by foregrounding, it means we make that work in a very different from the ordinary use of language. That is by disrupting. Disruptive means to say, to change it. The modes of ordinary linguistic discourse. Ordinary linguistic discourse means, as I said earlier, bring me a glass of water. That is ordinary linguistic, communication. But literature makes a strange. Literature, when it uses the same kind of language, but in a very different manner. And that language, seems to us a strange one. The world of everyday perception renews the reader's lost capacity for fresh sensation. In a movie, when we go to a movie, we see that, the dialogues are almost spoken in the same language, which we also hear. But, they make us understand the same language in a very different manner. I here want to, give you one another example. That suppose we daily eat chapati or roti. But suppose I paint a big chapati, on a canvas, and I hang it, that picture of chapati. Simple, you just imagine that on a blank page, there is a round chapati, and I just hang it somewhere. Then the same chapati which we eat will give a very different meaning. It means, suppose I want to say that, life revolves around chapati. That the round shape of the chapati can also, give us an idea. Different, the same chapati, when it is painted and shown, that means, if I study the form of that, it means the same chapati from my day-to-day life now becomes a very different thing, and it gives me a very different sensation, very different meaning, and, that will make me think more about the exact efforts of mine in our day-to-day life, that I work hard to get chapati. So there can be different meanings. It means fresh meanings are there. And what happens when we live our day-to-day life, we have a loss of our capacity for fresh sensations. So literature gives us a fresh sensation if we understand and try to understand formalistically to that literature. Next slide. Now, that does not wholly dismiss the formalistic approach, but insists that the methods of formal analysis are necessary, but sufficient. Necessary, but sufficient. Because they neglect the social world with which the human beings who write and read literature are bound up. As I earlier said that in formalistic approach, there is nothing to do with the common world, ordinary world, its history, its cultural connections. The form of art is to a certain and very large degree independent. But the artist who creates this form and the spectator who is enjoying it are not empty machines. One for creating form and the other for approaching, appreciating it. They are living human beings with a crystallized psychology representing a certain unity, even if not entirely harmonious. This psychology is the result of social conditions. Now, why I have read this passage? It means those people who dismiss formalistic approach. Somebody who says that, okay, form is more important. Then tell me that why the chapati has come in the round shape only. It means, do you consider that, you know, the person who's looking at the art, consuming the art, or someone who's writing art, creating art, are empty machines? They are robots, and they don't have understanding from some cultural background or historical background or community background. Suppose I'm a Dalit, and my suppression throughout the ages, suppose, though I am not a Dalit, I am a Brahmin. But suppose I read it and now I understand that my understanding and enjoying of literature will be totally different. My understanding, my psychology, or my appreciation of a work of art depends on my conditioning. And that is social. And suppose a writer who writes and creates, or an artist who creates an art, his psychology is also important. It means this form of criticism was very quickly dismissed, and they said that the formalists were thus accused of being politically reactionary because of such unpatriotic remarks as Slowacki's, that art was always free of life. As I earlier said that these Jacobson, Slowacki, Mukhorovsky, these writers, you know, French, sorry, Russian writers, they said that art is free from life and its color never reflected the color of the flag which waved over the fortress of the city. It means under which country you are living, art does not reflect that. But then it means you are not patriotic. So people, you know, accused them that they are unpatriotic, and, you know, and because of that, they had to leave Russia. And the leaders of the movement suffered political persecution in the beginning of the 1920s. So earlier I said that, you know, when Russian Revolution began and there was a lot much patriotic frenzy in Russia, these critics, you know, fell out of favor. When Joseph Stalin came to power, which largely put an end to their inquiries, there means formalistic critics. Because you should understand that formalistic critics said that art is more important and culture is less important. And culture, you know, culture thrives in a country. So you have to look at the country also. But their ideas continued to influence subsequent thinkers, partly due to Zevtan's, Todorov's translations. This another name that he translated these works, and because of him, you know, these things reached England and America in 1960s and 70s. So you should understand that these works were written before the starting of 1920s, clear? But these works of formalistic criticism, they reached the world in 1960s and 70s to the English speaking world, and including Todorov himself. So Barthes, Ronald Barthes, you know that person who's famous in structuralism and post-structuralism both, and Janet, and you know, Joss. These three names should be remembered. These were highly influenced by these formalistic approaches. In next slide, I'm just talking about this Coleridge's Biographia Literaria. You know, in that famous work of criticism, Samuel Taylor Coleridge very long ago described the prime merit of literary genius to be the representation of familiar objects so as to evoke freshness of sensation. Now I'm linking it that it was not only in the very beginning. Coleridge, in his famous Biographia Literaria, in that book, He also said that this is the work of a poet, that he creates a kind of strangeness in the familiar objects that he called like willing suspension of disbelief. He associated it. And in the Biographia Literaria in 1817, Samuel Taylor Coleridge had long before described the prime merit of literary genius to be representation of familiar objects so as to evoke freshness of sensation. But whereas the Romantic critic had stressed the author's ability, if we go to Wordsworth, Shelley, Keats, they said that it is author's ability to express a fresh mode of experiencing the world. The formalistic stresses the function of purely literary devices. Now let me understand. Coleridge also talked about he was a Romantic writer. Earlier I said that Romantic writers were different. Romantic writers said that it is the genius of an author. That author creates freshness of sensation because of his imagination. But these formalistic critics, what they said? They said that it is the literary devices, the grammar, the meter, the use of meter, the use of other things in language that produce the effects of freshness in the reader's experience of a literary work. So the foregrounded properties are artistic devices. Earlier I explained foregrounded means. Foregrounding means to bring to prominence a particular sentence or a particular thing which a formalistic critic is analyzing. Artistic devices, suppose I'm reading only the meter or say particular synonyms in a particular sentence, then you will be surprised to know that these synonyms are creating a very different meaning in the poem, which estrange poetic language are often described as deviations from ordinary language. Because when we write that suppose I read that line from Robert Burns, my love is a red rose. Now we all know that what is red rose, but there, the way he compares beauty of beloved with the red rose, and by writing red twice, there is a stress. So that form, it, because we in our day-to-day life never stresses that way. Clear? So that deviates, that changes the ordinary meaning of a language and gives it a kind of new meaning or freshness. Such deviations, which are analyzed most fully in the writings of Roman Jacobson, consist primarily in setting up and also violating patterns in the sound and syntax of poetic language. You know that a poet, he violates means he moves away from the sounds and syntax of the ordinary language, including patterns in speech sounds, grammatical constructions. Suppose let me tell you that mostly in our day-to-day life we speak subject verb object kind of grammatical structure, but in poetry we invert also. Like 10,000 did I see, that poem written by Wordsworth, we call it Daffodils. He is not saying that I saw 10,000 flowers. He says 10,000 did I see. Yeah, 10,000 saw I. So object first, then subject, and then object. So it's altogether the change of the form and then speech sound. Suppose alliteration is used particularly and deliberately, knowingly in a particular sentence or a poem, it creates a rhythm, a rhyme, and a stanza form, and also in setting a prominent recurrence of keywords or images, a particular word or image a writer evokes or creates. That these things are studied more, and they never pay attention to these formalistic writers, never pay attention to formalistic critics, they never pay attention to the cultural background or historical background. American New Criticism, although it developed independently, is sometimes called formalistic, as I earlier said, because New Criticism also pay attention to the content more, or say form or style, or the word, the material of a particular work of art. But they are sometimes called formalist because, like European formalism, it stresses the analysis of the literary work as a self-sufficient verbal entity. Okay, so you can understand, like there are many books, for example, Well Wrought On, there is a book, and then Verbal Icon. There are many books written in that age where in New Criticism, in which verbal entity, vocabulary, the words the writer has used, that becomes more important, constituted by internal relations. And what relationships are there in the words and sentences in between a particular poem or a work of art, and independent of the references either to the state of mind of the author or the external world. It means new criticism, though it is different, I will be making another video on that. New criticism is different, but somehow, because it also pays attention to the form, to the, to the content and vocabulary and grammar, and they close read a particular text to understand its meaning. And then they don't pay attention to the what was the condition of the state of the mind of author or, external world. So we can say that new criticism is also a kind of formalism. It also, like European formalism, conceives poetry as a special mode of language. They say that a poetic language is a very special use of language, not ordinary use of language, whose distinctive features, distinctive means special, features are defined in terms of their systematic opposition to practical or scientific language. It means in literature, the same language is used, the same word, you all know that language is same, and the same language will be used by the scientists also, and the same words are same. Like suppose I use potato, suppose I use a flower, suppose I use laboratory, words are same. But when these words are used in literature, they give a very different meaning, because through defamiliarization and through the artistic devices, a writer, by writing it in a very different grammar, the writer writes it by creating a stanza form, by creating a different form, they make that language new, strange when we look at. But the same language, when used in scientific or practical usage, that language remains the same. So there is in a scientific book of physics or chemistry, suppose same words come, but then that language does not create a kind of sensation in us. Okay, we never say wah wah when we read a book of physics, but when we read a book of poetry, we almost stop here and start thinking, because the language, the same language, is used in a different form. Unlike the European formalists, however, the new critics did not. Now, what am I doing on this slide? I'm just discussing the difference between new critics and formalists. Clear? So new critics did not apply the science of linguistics to poetry. Now, this is the major difference, that they did not apply the linguistic, because science of linguistics means linguistic understanding to poetry, and their emphasis was not on the work as constituted by linguistic devices for achieving special literary effects, but on the complex interplay within a work of irony. Let me clear it, that new critics, suppose they ask you in the exam that what is the difference between new criticism and formalism, then you will understand that new critics say that there is a complex interplay within a work. Like suppose the work creates irony, there is a paradox, there is a metaphorical different meaning is coming out around a humanly important theme. It means they don't apply linguistics, but formalistic critics, they apply linguistics, the knowledge of linguistics they apply. Now, the influence of Russian and Czech formalism on American criticism has been on the development of stylistics and of narratology. Now, this sentence is very important, that main influence of these formalistic criticism on American critics is they developed a very different branch of linguistics, and that we call stylistics. That suppose I apply some linguistic analysis on a particular poet's poem, then I come to know that, oh my God, he writes in a very different style. So to understand the style of a particular writer, it became another branch, we call it stylistics and narratology. How a thing is narrated, in what form it is narrated. Okay, and Roman Jakobson and Todorov have been influential in introducing formalistic concepts and methods into French structuralism. So you should understand that there is a French structuralism is simple French structuralism, where we study in the coming time, Saussure we will be studying. Okay, so you can understand that Jakobson and Todorov, they were the formal influence in the bringing of structuralism. Strong opposition to formalism, both in its European and American varieties, has been voiced by some Marxist critics who view it as the product of a reactionary ideology, and more recently by proponents of reader response criticism, speech act theory, and new historicism. Let me explain it now clearly, that later on, as I earlier told you, that today we don't have any formalistic criticism. Why? Because today we see that any work of art is, it depends on reader, it depends upon the psychology of the writer, how, you know, a particular sentence is used, why a particular sentence is used. And new historicism means the historicity of text, that, you know, a text is not written in a vacuum. It is always affected by some ideology, some history, some, you know, context in history. So these last three types of criticism, namely reader response criticism, speech act theory, and new historicism, all reject the views that there is a sharp and definable division between ordinary language and literary language. What have been we studying right from the beginning in today's lecture? That formalist critics say that ordinary language is made estranged and defamiliarized when it is used in literary language. But these critics say that no, ordinary language and literary language is one and the same thing, and same forces are working, you know, to give meaning. In the 1990s, a number of critics have called for a return to a formalist mode of treating a work of literature primarily as literature, instead of with persistent reference to its stand, whether explicit or covert. Covert means hidden, or political or racial or sexual issues. Now, what is this? It means today now there are many critics who say that we are fed up with this theory now. We are fed up that any poem you start teaching in a college, you start giving us political meaning associated with the poem, some racial. Suppose I'm reading Ramayana, and then I start criticizing the racial issues in that, or say sexual issues, that Sita was, you know, misused, Sita was abused, Sita, you know, I start using, you know, the sexual issues of feminism and all. It means I will kill the aesthetic aspects of that work. So now there are many critics who say that, fed up with these things, and let us go back to the formalism only, and let us not apply the historical, political, whether it is outwardly or inwardly, we should not apply all these things. So this is another important thing, that there is another force which is bringing us back to formalism.